Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's program, Chasing Eclipse with Mr. Fred Espenak. My name is Hamza Tariq, and I'm from the events team at the Central Library. Alongside me is my colleague Kai and Roland Deschain and Simon Poole from the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. The Calgary Public Library is excited and thrilled to offer another exciting program today in partnership with Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. Before passing over to Roland to introduce our speaker today, I would like to go over a few housekeeping things. At the bottom of your screen, you have an option of Q&A, raise hand, and chat. Please use the chat option if you run into any technical problems, and myself or Kai will be happy to help. You're welcome to ask questions during the discussion or save them till the end of the program by using the Q&A option or raise hand. Once you raise your hand, Simon will unmute you and you will be able to ask the question. Now, without any further delay, I will pass it on to Mr. Roland.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the October general meeting of the Calgary Center of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. As Hamza has mentioned, I am being helped with co-hosting tonight with Simon Poole, who is our first vice president of our local chapter. I am the president for another month or so. We've got elections at our next month's meeting, so stay tuned for big changes. For the better, no doubt. So I'm just going to share a screen with my presentation on it. There we go. There's our logo with Urania, the Muse of Astronomy, on it, and the royal designation. So just to open up with a little bit of astronomy content, we had the harvest moon at the start of the month, and I clipped an iPhone to the eyepiece of an 8-inch telescope and tried to get a shot of the rising moon at the horizon. The trees came out quite clear, but the moon was much further and had the photons had to travel through a much greater amount of atmosphere, and that's why it was kind of blurry in the background there. Also this month, Mars came into opposition, its closest approach to Earth for approximately a 2-year span. And one of our veteran observers grabbed a quick sketch of the planet during the close approach. We often have not great seeing, as we call it, the air turbulence in the atmosphere near the mountains. Kind of makes Calgary not the best place to be looking at fine details on planets, but you can certainly tell that Russ Chandler had a view of the planet and some of the dark markings there. So I'm going to introduce a little bit about our society and the benefits of membership. I'm going to run through the upcoming events and activities, and unfortunately due to COVID-19, many of these events are club events, not open to the public, but I am going to highlight one event at the end that is open to the public, and I hope you join us in about 1 month's time. And of course, afterwards that, we're going to have Mr. Eclipse, Mr. Fred Espenak, talking about chasing eclipses. So, about the RASC, as we like to call ourselves, because Royal Astronomical Society of Canada is quite a mouthful, we have monthly meetings, and you're in one of those right now. Because of COVID, it's being virtual before COVID, and hopefully after COVID, we'll be having physical meetings at the Calgary Public Library downtown. So we are continuing working with them during COVID with these virtual meetings. We also have a number of public star nights. We have our Wilson Cooley Observatory. That's the photos on the side there. You can see the dome with our 14-inch telescope in it. It's a 16-foot dome. And the foreground building is a roll-off roof observatory with the front flipped down. And we have quite a few telescopes in there nowadays. We have extensive website with sky highlights, star charts, and a bunch of astronomical events, what's up in the sky. We have our monthly newsletter. And because we're part of a national society with over 5,000 members, we have these perks of the membership, which includes Sky News Magazine and the journal, which are coming out every couple of months. And unfortunately, because of COVID, this is suspended, but our Telescope for Rent program is a great reason to join our club. Telescope equipment is relatively expensive and it's quite specialized, and it's very easy to purchase the incorrect instrument for you and your enjoyment of the hobby. And what we have is a program where you get to try out different types of equipment before you put down your own dollars to buy something typically in the hundreds, if not even thousands of dollars. And this is a really great perk, and hopefully we'll be back at it with our Telescope for Rent program once COVID eases. We also have the Eccles Ranch Observatory, a dark site observing site near the town of Caroline in west central Alberta. And we have star parties out there where everyone gets out their telescopes and goes camping. It's great fun. We also have a youth group for kids 11 years and older. We also provide you lots of observing information and stuff like that. And of course, locally, we have quite a big library of astronomical educational books and so on. And one of the things I'm very passionate about and heavily involved in, light pollution abatement. And so we have quite a crew here in Calgary and across the country looking at lighting smarter. We're not saying don't get rid of nighttime lighting. We're just saying there's a better way to use light that is good for the environment and better for safety. So we're just going to run through the upcoming events and calendar. For October, members will note that the Wilson Cooley Observatory key fees are now due and the lock change has occurred. Earlier this week, we had Mars in opposition and it was brightest for the year. It'll be prominent in the night sky for quite a few weeks still, and it's still not noticeably smaller than it was on Tuesday. Tomorrow, Friday 16th, the new Observers to Visual Astronomy and Combined Youth Group meeting will be held online. These are for members. It's a great way if you're new to the hobby of astronomy and want to learn about astronomy, becoming a member and getting to participate in some of these types of meetings is a good leg up in the hobby. Saturday, we're going to have our more advanced observers group meeting. It's also online at the moment. And on the 31st, we have the most distant full moon of 2020. It's also been called the Hunter's Moon and also known as a blue moon by the modern definition, which is the second full moon in the month. Also on Saturday, Uranus is at opposition and brightest for the year. So it's important to keep all your eyes on the skies this month and enjoy yourself and have a happy Halloween there with two neat astronomical events occurring on the same day or night, technically. That same overnight period, daylight saving time ends. Hooray. Monday morning, our own Don Holadiak will be on CBC Radio 1 with his Eye on the Sky. Lots of interesting news about the latest breaking science in astronomy, as well as updates on space missions. Our youth group meetings on the next Friday at 7:30. Our council meeting is the Thursday the 12th in the evening. And Friday the 13th is our next NOVA, New Observers to Visual Astronomy meeting. The observers group follows on the 14th. And then the next public event is our event here with Calgary Public Library again on Thursday the 19th. Dr. Cherry Ng, Unraveling the Mysterious Fast Radio Burst with CHIME. and that's the Canadian Hydrogen Intensity Measurement Experiment, and the view of the radio telescope out by Penticton at the Dominion Radio Astrophysical Observatory is there in the photo. That same evening, we're going to go to a closed meeting for members only, and that's our annual general meeting, and it immediately follows Dr. Ng's talk, which is open to the public, and we'll have a second Zoom meeting for the annual general meeting. Approximately 8:15, I would imagine. It's when we have our elections. We also have a new set of bylaw amendments, and we'll have a few member showcases, so highlighting some of the observing highlights of their year, and maybe we'll see some great photography or some sketches or a new piece of equipment being reviewed. So now, tonight's main event, Fred Espenak, Mr. Eclipse. He's got a master's degree from the University of Toledo. There he is, he just waved at everybody, taking a sip. He did this master's based on studies that he did with observing at Kitt Peak Observatory of eruptive and flare stars amongst red dwarfs. He worked a long time at Goddard Space Flight Centre. He used infrared spectrometers to measure the atmospheres of planets in the solar system. He's currently retired. And he has provided NASA's Eclipse Bulletin since 1978, which is actually the year I got involved with the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. So that's a long, long time. Fred has written a number of books and atlases on the subject of eclipses, and you'll be able to find and purchase those at his website at www.mistereclipse.com. And so now I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and we're going to have Fred Espenak talking about chasing eclipses.
Sorry, Roland, before we hand it over to Fred, I just want to quickly do a recap for everyone that has just joined in. I would like to go over the housekeeping things. At the bottom of your screen, you have an option of Q&A, raise hand, and chat. Please use the chat option if you run into any technical problems, and Kai and myself will help. You're welcome to ask questions during the discussion or save them till the end of the program by using the Q&A option or raise hand option. Once you use the raise hand option, Simon will unmute you and you will be able to ask the question. Also, before I pass it over to Fred, I'm going to be putting up a poll, and I would encourage everyone to participate in. This poll will give you a question and give you a few options, and it will just take a few seconds. So I'm going to put the poll up in just 1 second here. There you go. So you guys should see the poll. Like I said, I'll keep it up for a minute. And right after a minute, if Fred can jump on and start his talk, that would be great.
When Simon first invited me to speak at RASC Calgary, I thought this would be a great opportunity to go visit Banff again and do some photography. And I'd even arranged for a rental car. Of course, COVID popped up and changed everybody's plans. But just to remind me that there was a life before COVID, 3 days ago, I got a reminder that I still had a car reserved for me in Calgary, which I had to cancel. Anyway, I'm glad to be able to visit you remotely. And I'm going to, of course, be speaking about eclipses tonight. See if I can get into my PowerPoint. I seem to still have this poll on my screen. Ah, it's gone. Oops, it's back.
Fred, is it still there?
Yeah.
Okay,
so we're good to go. So I'm going to talk about eclipses this evening. And I want to start out with just some basics, because we've got an audience with a wide range of experiences, from rank beginners to seasoned amateurs who've been in astronomy for decades. But the absolute requirement for an eclipse of the sun is that the moon has to be in a new moon phase. So it's passing between the sun and the earth so that its shadows can hit the earth's surface. Now the moon has two shadows. The inner shadow, the darker shadow, is the umbra, and the outer shadow is the penumbra. The penumbra is quite large. It's probably about 5 or 6,000 kilometers in diameter, whereas the umbra is only about 1 to 200 kilometers, so it's much smaller. And as the moon orbits the earth during the course of an eclipse, its shadows sweep across the earth's surface, and the umbral shadow, that inner shadow, carves out what's called the path of totality. And you've got to be located somewhere in that narrow path, typically only 1 or 200 kilometers in diameter or wide. You've got to be in that narrow path in order to see the total eclipse of the sun. And what do you see during a total eclipse? The sun's bright disk is completely occulted by the moon, and you see the sun's spectacular solar corona. This is the only time you can see it with the naked eye, is during a total solar eclipse. But that total phase, called totality, typically lasts only 1 or 2 or 3 minutes. It can actually range in time anywhere from a second up to about 7.5 minutes. But the average total eclipse is only about 2 or 3 minutes long. Well, that brings up a question. If a solar eclipse can only happen at new moon, why don't we have a solar eclipse every single month? We've got a new moon every 29.5 days. Well, the reason we don't have it is because the moon's orbit is tipped about 5 degrees to the Earth's orbit around the sun. That's easier to see in this kind of a cartoon, where you see the moon, in this case, is passing above the plane of the Earth's orbit, so the shadow passes above Earth and misses us, or it can pass below the Earth most of the time during most new moons. But at least twice a year, some part of the moon shadow will hit the Earth and we'll get some type of a solar eclipse. Now, most of the time, those are not total eclipses. For the total eclipse to take place, again, you've got to have that umbral shadow hitting the Earth and producing that path of totality. There's a second kind of solar eclipse that's worth mentioning, and that's called the annular eclipse. And annular comes from the Greek annulus, or ring. And what we've got in this case is the moon is a little bit further away from the Earth, and it appears smaller than the sun. So its shadow actually turns in on itself and produces this negative shadow here. What does that mean? Well, it means, and that shadow sweeps across the Earth just like in a total eclipse, and you get this path of annularity. But what happens in this annular path is that the moon appears smaller than the sun, and it can't completely cover the sun's disk. So you're left with a ring or annulus of sunlight surrounding the moon during the middle phase. Now, because you've got some of the sun's visible disk seen during the annular phase, you don't get the darkness of totality, and you don't get the solar corona visible. So annular eclipses really aren't nearly as impressive as a total eclipse. Why do we have total eclipses and annular eclipses? It's because the moon's orbit is elliptical in shape, and it varies from about 400,000 kilometers to about 356,000 kilometers. And that variation in distance of about 14% means about half the time the moon appears a little bit larger than the sun, and half the time it's a little bit smaller than the sun. So it depends on the timing of when a particular eclipse takes place. whether the moon is near perigee or apogee. During the apogee part of the orbit, the moon's going to appear smaller than the sun and you'll get an annular eclipse, whereas during the perigee part, it's larger than the sun and you'll get a total eclipse. How often do these eclipses take place? If we look at 5,000 years we can calculate the circumstances for every solar eclipse over a 5,000 year interval. And we find over that period that there are nearly 12,000 eclipses of the sun, 11,898 to be exact. And we find the statistics for the different types of eclipses is shown in this pie diagram over here. Partial eclipses constitute about 35% of all solar eclipses that take place. Total eclipses is about 26-27%. Annular eclipses is about 33%. And then we've got a fourth category called the hybrid eclipse, and that's down about 5%. Let me say a word or two about a hybrid eclipse. With a hybrid eclipse, the path of totality begins as an annular eclipse. It turns into total for part of the path, and then it turns back into annular. So you get annular, total, annular at most of these hybrid eclipses. The reason for that is just the curvature of the Earth along different points along the path of totality bring you far enough into the moon's shadow that you get a total eclipse, whereas at the end points, they're further away from the sun and the moon isn't quite large enough to cover the sun, so you get an annular eclipse at the ends. So they're unusual. They're only about, as I said, 5% of all eclipses. Well, there are actually, on average, about 2.5 eclipses every year. But the actual number can range from anywhere from 2 eclipses to 5 eclipses in a single year. In terms of total eclipses, some years have 0. Some years have 1 eclipse. On very rare occasions, you can get a year, calendar year, that has 2 total eclipses. In that case, the first total eclipse is in January, and the second total eclipse is 12 months later in December. Well, let's take a quick look at the sequence of events that takes place during a total eclipse. It starts with what's called first contact, when that first bite of the moon takes a bite out of the sun, and the moon slowly moves across the sun. This is a very slow process. It typically takes about an hour or an hour and a quarter for the moon to slowly cover up the sun during this period of time. And at this time, you need to be viewing the sun, the partial phases of the eclipse, with solar filters of some sort, because the sun is still blindingly bright, literally. But as the moon gets close to the total phase, when only a thin crescent is left, if you go underneath shade trees, you start to see that the leaves in the trees form pinhole cameras and they project images of the crescent sun on the ground. The temperature drops as you get close to the total phase of the eclipse. Here's a temperature graph from an eclipse back in 2006, where the temperature has dropped about 9 degrees Celsius or 16 Fahrenheit from what it would have been without the eclipse. Animals start reacting to the light as it starts to drop as totality approaches. They might gather and roost, preparing for the evening. And in the last minute or so, the crescent shrinks to an extremely thin hairline crescent. And that crescent breaks up into a brilliant bead as the daylight dwindles and drops down. The corona starts to be visible, and suddenly you're plunged into totality. You're in this eerie twilight, and the sun's corona is revealed to you. Looking around the horizon, you're in this eerie twilight. You can see some of the brighter first magnitude stars and any bright planets that are in the sky. And around the horizon, you get the colors of dawn or dusk, because you're looking out the edge of the moon's shadow into areas that are still illuminated by sunlight. Well, this twilight doesn't last long. And soon the sun starts to reappear along the edge of the moon. It first appears along some deep valleys along the moon's edge. These are called Bailey's beads. And they quickly merge together into a crescent. And the eclipse becomes too bright to look at with the naked eye. You've got to use filters again. As the diamond ring is seen and daylight returns. And it's usually at this point you ask yourself, when is the next total eclipse? Because these things are just exceptional events. They're unlike anything, any other natural event that I've ever seen. Now, my first eclipse was 50 years ago on March 7th, 1970. That eclipse path crossed the eastern coast of the United States. And I managed to get down to the path of totality, had great weather, even managed to get some pictures through my little department store refractor. And that was just the start of a lifetime of chasing eclipses around the world. My next total eclipse was in the Gaspé Peninsula in 1972, but unfortunately I was clouded out. And this is one of the risks about eclipses. You can predict where an eclipse is going to be to an amazing precision, to within a second or less of when the total phase will begin and when it will end. Not so accurate are the weather predictions, whether you're going to have good weather or not, especially when you're planning an eclipse trip to go to a remote part of the world, maybe in another continent, months in advance to plan such a trip. Another eclipse that I traveled to in North Africa, the Sahara Desert, was in 1973. And I've traveled all around the world to see eclipses at this point. Over the past 49 years, I've been to 29 total eclipses, which are represented by the little total eclipse symbols here. I've been to 11 annular eclipses and 8 partial eclipses. Even down to Antarctica for an eclipse in 2003. And people sometimes ask me, well, once you've seen one total eclipse, aren't they all the same? Why do you keep going to them? Well, every total eclipse is different because the sun's corona is different. It varies with the sunspot cycle. It's highly dependent on the magnetic fields of the sun, because the corona is a superheated plasma. So it's a series of charged particles, primarily ions of heavy metals and electrons, and they are susceptible to magnetic fields and they fall along the magnetic field lines in the sun's atmosphere and produce these intriguing patterns. So every solar eclipse is different.
Telescope filters.
Now, just to give you an example of what it's like to see a total eclipse, I've got a little video that was shot back in China, back in 2008.
Telescope filters off. 50 seconds. Shadow to the northwest.
See how dark it is now? We're ready to take a whole
30 seconds. Okay. 25.
So this is the diamond ring.
Corona.
Yeah, there's Venus.
Venus.
Wow. Wow, I see the corona.
Bailey's beads, totality.
Look to your camera, Jeff. There's a prominence at 3 o'clock. You might be able to see it if your eyes are better than mine, but I can't see it without my camera.
Prominence.
You see it? The little pink thing? See Mercury?
Oh, yeah.
30 seconds.
Look at the horizon. Look at the horizon.
25 seconds.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, look how bright it's getting. Look at the shape of the shadow cone.
You see it? See it? See that V over there?
15 seconds.
Yeah, yeah.
Chromosphere, 10 seconds.
Chromosphere, 5 o'clock. See that, Jeff? Yep, oh my God, here it comes.
Here it comes. Here beads, comes. Bailey's beads.
Take pictures, take pictures.
Woohoo!
So that gives you an idea of how much excitement there is at the eclipse. The excitement in everybody's voices and the changing lighting and the view of the sun. It's just incredible. Well, the most recent, one of the most recent total eclipses was 3 years ago, August 21st, 2017, when we had a total eclipse that passed through the United States. It was the first total eclipse through the 48 states since 1979. So a 38 year gap between total eclipses. And the path was about 100 kilometers in diameter. And it swept from Oregon across the US west to east and crossed into South Carolina before crossing into the North Atlantic. Now I was located in Casper, Wyoming, right about here. And this was a real novelty for me, this particular eclipse, because I didn't have to worry about packing telescopes in two suitcases and taking them halfway around the world with airline regulations. No, not in this case. I filled up my SUV with four refractors. I was operating 17 cameras for the 2017 eclipse. So it was a very busy day with a lot of setup time. A couple of my neighbors from Arizona came with me. This was their first total eclipse. And they wanted to see what, they had heard all my stories and they wanted to see for themselves what the eclipse was like. And they are now eclipse chasers. They've been bitten by the bug. This is a wide angle video shot in Casper on eclipse day. It starts about 1 minute before the total eclipse begins.
Scope filters off.
Boy, can I take this off? Okay.
15.
Okay, filters off, Roy.
Video filters off. Video filters off. 40.
Oh, man.
Take
our glasses off. Oh my God! Look at that!
Oh!
Oh my God!
Oh.
I wasn't prepared for this, Fred. Oh my God! Look at that, Roy. Isn't that cool? Oh my God!
30.
Oh my God! There's a cloud through there, but it's still beautiful, isn't it? Oh my God! This is so strange. Oh, look at these!
Wow!
15.
Oh my God! Oh,
plus 16.
Max eclipse in 10 seconds. Oh my God.
Maximum.
hit eclipse.
This eclipse is a little longer.
Oh, max eclipse.
60 seconds to third.
Yeah.
I see Regulus to the left of the sun.
Oh, man.
Fifty seconds left.
Oh, man. Oh, my God. That, oh.
20.
Third contact, 15
oh
seconds.
Oh, my God.
15 seconds.
12, oh, look 11, at that.
10, 9, oh. 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Third contact.
Oh.
3, 2,
oh! Oh, look at that! Oh, oh my God! Woo. Oh, my word! Oh, my...
Watch receiving shadow.
That was crazy!
Replace solar filters.
Filters on.
Oh.
Replace solar
filters. Okay, that was cool.
15. Watch for shadow bands. Plus 16.
Wow.
Well, I spent the next 2 months processing all the images that I shot with those cameras. Most of them were automated. That was the diamond ring. Here's a wide angle during totality. And this is my proof. People often accuse me of never watching a total eclipse. I'm so busy with cameras and telescopes, but there I am actually viewing the eclipse with a pair of binoculars that I had with me, because I had most of my cameras automated with timers for this eclipse. Now, this image is a composite of about 57 separate exposures that I've combined in the computer and done some HDR processing, high dynamic range, in order to see both faint details in the inner corona as well as the outer corona, because there's such a range of brightness in the corona that it's hard to photograph it in any single one exposure. This comes closest, I think, to what the eclipse actually looked like with the naked eye. And you can see over on the left-hand side of the screen, I've even captured the star Regulus, Alpha Leo, over here. This is another similar image where I've pushed the processing a little harder to extract fine details in the corona to bring out all the very faint structure. Now, this is exaggerated. This is not what it would look like, but it reveals the detail that's present there in the sun's corona. I was shooting the eclipse at Casper College, right off the grounds of their geology museum. And out in front of their museum, they've got this bronze sculpture of a Tyrannosaurus Rex. So this was my dream come true, to watch an eclipse and have a dinosaur nearby. And I managed to get one of my cameras set up so that it would photograph the T-Rex with totality. This is shot right at the end of totality, at third contact as it's called. And you see Bailey's beads peeking out, beads of the sun through deep valleys along the moon. There was also a bright red hydrogen prominence off the surface of the sun visible there. And this is a video shot with a long video lens of third contact, the end of totality.
25.
Third contact, 15 seconds.
15 seconds.
12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Third contact.
Oh, look at that!
A time lapse made during totality, along with the partial phases of the eclipse. And the entire eclipse from start to finish in a mosaic. Well, the next total eclipse after 2017 was a year ago, on July 2nd, 2019. And that eclipse path, which is shown, the path of totality is this blue curve across the South Pacific, ending in South America. So I went to southern Chile, or central Chile, for this eclipse, with a group organized through Spears Travel. Our group had probably, about 60 or so people in the group. And we had made a site inspection trip the year before and found a wonderful location in Vicuña, Chile, at a place called Mamayuca Observatory. They had wonderful grounds there for our group where we could set up on the roof terrace of the visitor center, as well as outside the public observatory. So it was a great place to set up. And this is on eclipse day. And we had the kind of weather that eclipse chasers dream about. Not a single cloud in the sky, crystal clear, beautiful day and beautiful location. This was my eclipse setup for Chile. I had somewhat less than 17 cameras this time. I think I had only 8 or 9 cameras. This is the diamond ring effect right before totality begins. This is probably about 15 or 20 seconds before second contact. This is just a second or so before second contact, before totality begins, that last bead hanging on the edge of the sun before it disappears behind the moon's edge. And this is a time sequence from a series of images that I took of the start of the diamond ring effect and Bailey's beads before going into totality. A selfie during totality. I realize my wife and I have been shooting eclipse selfies long before they were called selfies. Now, with the most cameras, if you shot a long exposure during totality, you would end up with an image that looks like this, where the inner corona close to the edge of the moon is burnt out and it's all white. You can't see any details there, but you've got some little detail out here. And that's why I shoot these sequences of different exposures so I can combine them together to produce an image that more closely represents what the eclipse looked like to the naked eye. So this is what you get when you do some processing and you can bring out all that detail. And you can just about pick out the dark side of the moon as well. Here's an exaggerated version of that where you can pick out the moon's mare and bright craters. There's Copernicus is right over here, and Kepler, Tycho is up here. Now, you couldn't see this with the naked eye, but long exposures were able to reveal this during totality. This was probably a 4-second exposure. And the end of totality with Bailey's beads forming one time, some very nice prominences visible along the edge of the sun as totality ended. And the diamond ring. And another time sequence of Bailey's beads at the end of totality. a lot of happy faces when you everything goes well and you have perfect weather for the eclipse. Well, what is ahead? What do we have in the future for solar eclipses? So I'd like to give a brief preview. In just 2 months, there's another total eclipse through Chile and Argentina on December 14th. Unfortunately, with the current state of the world, with the global pandemic and no vaccine available for COVID-19, it is very unlikely I'll be able to go to Chile for this eclipse. I haven't canceled my plans yet, but it's very unlikely. In fact, right now, Americans aren't even allowed to fly to Chile. Of course, Americans right now aren't allowed to fly to most countries, wisely. But next year, on June 10th, 2021, there is an annular eclipse. Now, they're not as great as totals, but still, they're interesting looking. And in this case, the annular eclipse actually begins in Canada. Let's take a closer look at that. Here's the path of annularity. It is very large because it's low along the edge of the Earth and the shadow is stretched out. The problem with this particular eclipse is that it doesn't go through any big cities. It's a little difficult to get to, but it offers a wonderful opportunity to photograph an annular eclipse at sunrise, especially from the Canadian end of the eclipse path. It ends over in Siberia. This is an example of an annular eclipse right after annularity that's low in the sky. This one was in 2012. So you'll get a view something like this next June from Ontario with the sun just rising in annular eclipse. Weather prospects for the eclipse are a little iffy. You're looking at the fractional cloud amount over on the right-hand side. There's a scale here. And the scale, the way meteorologists do this, it seems a little upside down, I think. This is the fraction of cloud amount. So it's the amount of cloud that's visible on average along the eclipse path. So large numbers are lots of cloud. Low numbers are small amounts of cloud. But you can see even in some of the best weather would be down in this area. And even at that, it's typically about 60% cloud. So it's risky. But the fact that it's an annular eclipse and you can see it through thin cloud is an advantage here. This information comes from one of your fellow countrymen, Jay Anderson. He's a Canadian meteorologist and he's my writing partner on our Eclipse Bulletin series. And Jay runs a website called eclipsophile.com. And you can find a lot of great weather information for upcoming eclipses that he posts there. You can also find in next year's RASE Observer's Handbook some information about this particular eclipse in an article that I've written for the handbook. This is, I think, the 37th year that I've contributed an article about upcoming eclipses in the handbook. I started my first one in 1984 was my first article. So there's a lot more information about the eclipse there, as well as other eclipses during the year. The next total eclipse, well, now you've got to do some serious traveling because this one is in December 2021, a little over a year from now, and it crosses Antarctica into the South Atlantic. That's a difficult one to get to. But of course, there'll be cruises there. I'm going to be aboard a cruise run by Quark Expeditions called the Ocean Diamond is the ship that I'll be on. Our weather prospects are very challenging that time of year, or any time of year in Antarctica, there are a lot of clouds. But closer to home, there's another annular, this time in October 2023. This one crosses North America, Central America, and into South America. Let's take a closer look at the US. This is the southwestern portion of the United States. And this annular eclipse passes through Oregon, California, Nevada, Utah, Colorado, Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. So it's a close one to get to. It's a good one to rehearse for getting your equipment ready for the next total eclipse, which I'll talk about in a minute or two. This is a different type of a grass that Jay Anderson has produced for the 2023 annular. In this case, again, we're plotting the fractional amount of cloud. So high numbers is cloudy, low numbers is clear. And you're going along the eclipse path from Oregon, Nevada, Utah, Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. So you can see some of the best weather, the least likelihood of clouds is down here through Arizona and New Mexico, not surprisingly, where maybe there's a 30% chance of cloud cover. Again, Jay Anderson's website is eclipsophile.com. And this particular eclipse, because you can observe and photograph the entire eclipse from start to finish, unlike next year's 2021, which is already in progress at sunrise, the 2023, you get to see the eclipse from start to finish, and you can produce some interesting mosaics, like up in the right-hand corner here, of putting together all phases of the eclipse. I've published a book on the 2023 eclipse, which is basically a road atlas, which gives detailed maps across the entire eclipse path. But the real headline here for eclipses in the near future is the eclipse on April 8th, 2024, because that's the next total eclipse to pass through North America. It begins in the South Pacific, crosses Mexico, central USA, and eastern Canada. If we take a close-up of the Mexican portion of the eclipse path, Mazatlan, down on the Pacific coast, is right in the center of the eclipse path, and it'll have a duration there of 4 minutes and 27 seconds, which is very long for a total eclipse. That's unusually long. The point of greatest eclipse here in central Mexico is just a second longer, 4 minutes and 28. But this is a very difficult location to get and probably dangerous politically. Further to the north, it crosses the border into Texas, and the duration is still well over 4.5 minutes. In Texas, the city of Austin is inside the path, but right near the southern edge, whereas Dallas is more centrally located, big areas where you can fly in and fly out reasonably easily. Traveling to the north, the path crosses Missouri and into Illinois, and there's a small town called Carbondale, and I highlight that because Carbondale was also in the path of the 2017 eclipse. So Carbondale is the lucky location that gets two total eclipses in the span of just 7 years. Indianapolis is deep in the eclipse path in Indiana, and in Ohio, Cleveland is deep in the eclipse path. I'm just highlighting a couple of the larger cities. Getting into southern Canada, Toronto, unfortunately, is just outside the path of totality. You have to go down into some of the outlying regions down here to Hamilton is near the northern edge of the eclipse path, as is Kingston, over in this area. And Montreal is inside the eclipse path as well, near the northern edge of the eclipse path. And the path continues on across the Maine, across New Brunswick. It bisects Prince Edward Island. The western half of the island is in the path of totality. The eastern end is not, is only gets a partial eclipse. And it crosses Newfoundland. But St. John's, again, is outside the path of totality. Of course, we've got to consider the weather prospects for this eclipse. Again, a weather map by Jay Anderson. The blue colors tend to indicate low amounts of cloud, whereas the orange and reds are high amounts. So not surprisingly, in April, the further north you get, the less likely there is to have cloud-free skies. So the best options in terms of weather for this eclipse is either in Mexico or in Texas. But of course, these are cloud probabilities based on historical records of how often clouds occur in these areas. On eclipse day, you don't have probabilities, you don't have climate models. What you have is weather, and it can be clear any place along this eclipse path. No place is a guaranteed sure thing. Interesting thing about the 2024 total eclipse, which is the path, this is central Texas, the path that goes from lower left to upper right, this is the path, the totality of 2024. 6 months earlier, the annular eclipse crosses central Texas from the northwest to the southeast. So this shaded area in here is a location where you get an annular eclipse in October 2023 and a total eclipse in April 2024. So you can get two eclipses within the span of 6 months. Just a novelty. Well, you can find out a lot more about all the eclipses I've talked about and many others on the eclipse website that I run called eclipsewise.com. I've got maps and diagrams for 5,000 years of solar eclipses as well as lunar eclipses. And one of the things in particular that I want to call your attention to is that I have on this website, there are links to Google Maps that I have eclipse paths plotted on. So you can link, you can go to any of the eclipses and visit it on a Google map, and you can zoom in just like you can on any other Google map. And if you click on the map, it'll actually tell you what the duration time is of the eclipse and when the eclipse begins and ends for any location in the path. So that's a really useful planning tool. Well, I think that a total eclipse is one of the most awe-inspiring sights in nature. And once you've seen one, it's something you'll never forget. The danger is that these things are addictive. They are so beautiful, so exquisite, that you want to see another one if you visit the first one. Thank you very much. And I think we'll open it to questions now.
All right. Thank you very much, Fred. That was an excellent presentation. Very, very enjoyable. I'll start with questions on the Q&A, and then we'll move to if anybody wants to raise their hand and ask a question, I'll unmute you and you'll be able to ask your question live. So the first question on the Q&A is from Stephen, and he asks, is a hybrid eclipse something you are interested in viewing? Do you think it would be exciting?
The most interesting thing about a hybrid eclipse is the moon is just at along the sections of the path where it's total, the moon is just a hair's breadth larger than the sun. So it just barely fits on the sun's disk. Now, on the negative side of that, it means it's a short total eclipse. Hybrids rarely last any more than about 60 seconds. Very often they're shorter than that, 40 seconds, 30 seconds. On the plus side, because it's such a tight fit, you get to see the sun's chromosphere surrounding the whole disk of the moon. So you get this bright red ring in the very inner, the very lowest parts of the corona. The chromosphere is a layer just above the sun's photosphere, the bright yellow surface that we see through telescopes where it's sunset. So it's a great opportunity to really study the chromosphere of the sun and very photogenic too. So for that reason, hybrids are very interesting.
Great, thank you, Fred. Somebody just wants you to recap where you took that picture of the dinosaur and the eclipse. It's such an excellent picture.
That was at the Tate, T-A-T-E, Tate Geological Museum in Casper, Wyoming.
Awesome. And now, Jean asks, how do you automate the exposure times? Do you have a complex interferometer where you can program a sequence of exposure times as well as the number of exposures?
Yes, is the short answer. I have a device called a let me see if I can remember the name. Promote control. And I've got two of these things, and they're, you can think of them as a smart interval timer. And they have a lot of different functionality for doing something like this. I use them for shooting a bracketed series. I could program as many different exposures as with an interval between each one from 4 seconds up to maybe a thousandth of a second. The bad news is that the promote control is no longer being manufactured. You might be able to pick up one used, but there are other alternatives to automating eclipse photography. There are always new products on the market that are similar to promote control. There are also a Windows PC program called Eclipse Maestro, where you can run your Eclipse camera from a Windows laptop, and there's a, I'm sorry, I had that backwards. It's Eclipse Maestro is for the Macintosh. There's a similar program, very similar, called Eclipse Orchestrator. That's for a Windows machine. And either one of those, I used one of them. I think I used the Orchestrator on a little Windows laptop for the 2009 Eclipse, and that worked very well. So you can automate sequences using something like that.
That's great. I see a couple of people have their hands up, and we'll get to them in just a second. Mike asks, I see it seems okay to not use a filter for the diamond ring. Is that true?
Yes. In fact, if you leave a filter on for the diamond ring, you're really not going to get much. Now, this is something that requires a little finesse, a little bit of experience. I typically remove my filters because, for one thing, I've got so many cameras going. It takes me 10 seconds to get all the filters off 3 or 4 or 5 cameras. So I typically am pulling filters off 40 seconds, 45 seconds before totality. And I begin shooting the diamond ring typically about 30 seconds before totality, with the important caveat that I am not looking through the camera when I'm doing this, because that sliver of photosphere that's still visible is still dangerously bright. It's not going to damage your camera at this point, but you don't want to be staring directly into it. But you can shoot the diamond ring during those periods of time.
That's great. And Randy asks your opinion on the best filter, glass versus Mylar.
My experience has been primarily with glass filters. I've been using Thousand Oaks glass filters for probably 20 years and had very good success with them. But I think there are many other alternatives out there. I just haven't tested them. I've been happy with the Thousand Oaks filters, and I've stuck with them.
Great. And the last question from the chat is from Morgan. She asks, if my location is not on the path, will the eclipse still be sort of partially visible?
Oh yeah. If you're outside the eclipse path, you're most likely in the zone of the partial eclipse is 2,000 miles wide on either side of the path of totality. So I think all of Canada will see a partial eclipse next June. Even if you can't get into that path of annularity, or even if you can't get into the path of totality in 2024, you'll still see a partial eclipse. But let me give you an analogy in terms of total eclipses, or a couple of analogies. The difference between seeing a total eclipse and seeing a partial eclipse is like the difference between almost winning the lottery, having 5 out of 6 numbers in the lotto or whatever the numbers game is. You've lost. The difference, another analogy that I like to make is that on a scale of 1 to 10, in terms of the spectacularness of an eclipse, a partial eclipse is maybe a 5. An annular eclipse is more interesting because you get that symmetry of that ring. That might be a 7. A total eclipse is a million. A total eclipse is just so staggeringly spectacular that a partial eclipse doesn't compare to it. If you cannot get to the path of totality, certainly a partial eclipse is interesting to see, but let me urge you, you've got years to plan for April 2024. Try to make an effort to get into the path of totality, because it is something you will tell your grandchildren about. It's something you will never forget. And you will thank me and anybody else that convinced you to get into the path. Just do it. It's something that should be on everybody's bucket list.
That's great. Thanks, Fred. I'm going to go to the hands now, and then we'll go back to the chat. Gary Spears, you have a question. I'll unmute you, and you can ask your question.
Yeah, I just wanted to give a shout out to Fred. Fred and I go ways back, chasing eclipses all around the world. And I just got a quick story for you. We were in India, and there's very short eclipse, like 45 seconds. And Fred all had all of his cameras set up and everything like that. But he had a tape recorder. And back then it was probably a Walkman or something like that. Yeah. And so he had every maneuver for his cameras on this tape recorder that he was listening to, said, okay, filter on, take filter off, use this camera, click this, click that. And then one place in the middle of it, he said, okay, 2 seconds, look up. Okay, back to the, and it, that's what his tape recorder said. And one more shout out is that in India, that's where he met his future wife, so.
That's right. I met Pat there in India at that eclipse. That was her first total eclipse. We've been on many total eclipses together since then.
Yep. So great presentation.
Thanks, Gary. Good to talk to you.
Gary Tarasoff, if you can unmute, you can ask your question.
Oh, yeah, I didn't have any real questions. Was just kind of taking in the pictures and looking forward to the next one.
Great. Now, Rick Brown, I believe you have a question.
Can you hear me?
Hey, Rick, how you doing?
Hi, Fred, how are you doing?
Good.
Good
keep
to see
head above water with COVID, you know?
Yeah, well, we're still trying to make it. We haven't canceled yet, but who knows?
Yeah, we're in the same boat.
I know. I wanted to ask you, Fred, what's the maximum distance that the moon can be from the Earth that's going to be kind of the threshold between a total and a hybrid?
Ooh, I don't have that. I don't have that number in my head. I'd have to look that up.
Okay. Well, hopefully I'll see you in Chile.
Yeah, I hope so.
We'll be right between Pucón and Villarrica. We've got a house there.
Okay, very nice.
So hopefully we're going to make it. We'll see.
Yeah. Stay in touch.
I'll look for you down there if we make it.
Thanks.
We'll be in touch.
Thank you, Rick. I'm going to go back to some more of the chat questions. Let me just go back. So Akhil is asking a question. In trying to understand the eclipse chaser's mind, if the 2021 solar eclipse were total and given the fractional cloud outlook, for example, 0.6 for Baffin Island, where they would like to chase, would you chase that eclipse?
Sure, if I can get there. Annulars can be very interesting. I personally would not go to Baffin myself. I'd rather go to the sunrise part in in Ontario near the shore of Hudson Bay in that region down there, simply because I think the nice thing about an annular, it gives you a unique opportunity to do a kind of a landscape shot of the annular eclipse with some interesting foreground as the sun rises. That's the real unique thing about the 2021 eclipse, is to try to get it as it's rising out of the the horizon, as in the annular phase, and you get that atmospheric squashing of the sun. So it's a very unique photograph. Once the sun gets high up in the sky, it's, you know, and the annular eclipse isn't quite as interesting, and you can easily get that kind of an eclipse 2 years later in 2023 when the path crosses the U.S. With better weather prospects too. So I would recommend the central Ontario rather than Baffin Island, unless you've really got a hankering to get up to Baffin.
Great. Peter asks a question. Eclipse paths over multiple years have various shapes on the globe with curves rising and falling. Is this because for some, the moon's ecliptic path is rising from below to above the Earth's ecliptic path, and others are from above to below?
That's exactly right. You've got the point where the moon's orbit in the sky crosses the Earth's orbit around the sun is called the node. And there's the ascending node where the moon moves from below the Earth's orbit to above the Earth's orbit. And then there's the descending node where it crosses from above the orbit to below the orbit. Also factored into here, the shape of the path is the season that the eclipse takes place, because that tips the Earth's pole towards or away from the sun. And you get a different pattern as the shadow crosses different lines of latitude at different angles. So you get some very complicated and weird looking shapes.
Great. We just have a few more questions. Eric asks, do you enjoy experiencing totality in a smaller group or in larger crowded groups? Does the energy of a larger crowd add to the overall experience for you?
Boy, that's a mixed bag. In terms of my photography, I prefer a smaller group because less interruption. On eclipse day, I'm pretty tense. I'm focused on getting all my equipment right, and I'm probably not that pleasant to be around because I'm a little tense because of that. So a smaller group works better for me, but on the other hand, being around a larger group, there is a lot of energy and a lot of excitement. So if you're not quite as wrapped up in the technology of imaging the eclipse, it's probably more fun to be with a bigger group of people.
Great. Now just a couple more. Andrew asks, when people go on ocean cruises to see an eclipse, will the ship change its position to a location where the weather is best?
That depends entirely on the ship and on the captain. The captain always has the final word on a ship, but they usually make an effort to try to locate in the best place, but there are limits to how quickly a ship can maneuver. These things are big objects and they don't move very fast. So they may be able to tweak their position, maybe tens of miles, but they can't go hundreds of miles before the day before the eclipse. It's just not feasible to do something like that. So it depends on the particular ship you're on. They usually make an effort. They know it's an eclipse cruise. They make an effort to try to get in the eclipse path, into good weather.
Awesome. Alan Dyer, he asks, do you remember to look for shadow bands before and after totality? He says he always forgets.
I'm with you, Alan. I usually forget. Hi, Alan. I'm usually so wrapped up with my photography of the sun and the corona that usually I look at shadow bands when somebody else nearby says, hey, shadow bands. And then I'll look down and see them for a second or two. And then I go back to work. Other people are you know, that's the most exciting thing to them is shadow bands. So to each his own. Mm-hmm. There's something for everybody in a total eclipse.
Definitely. Jordy, he asks, what is your preferred focal length for capturing eclipses?
By that, I assume you mean in terms of photographing the sun's corona. And for that, something in the neighborhoods, and it also depends on whether using let's talk about a crop sensor camera first. With a crop sensor camera, I like to shoot with something in the neighborhoods of 400 to 700 millimeters. If it's a full frame sensor, then I want to go a little bit longer, more like 700 to 1000 millimeters. I don't want to get too tight in on the sun or moon's disk because I want to leave a lot of area around the edges of the frame to get the sun's corona there. So I find those focal lengths work well.
Great. And in a follow-up to this question, Mike and Ryan, they have similar questions. Mike asks, what camera settings for video and or stills generally? And Ryan, he asks a similar question. Is there a base set of aperture shutter speed you start with when setting up for the eclipse?
Well, if you ask six different eclipse chasers what they do, you're going to get six different answers. But my technique is I don't mess around with the aperture. I don't mess around with the ISO. Of course, when I started, there was no messing around with the ISO. The ISO was whatever film you had in your camera. Mm-hmm. But these days, you can adjust the exposure by playing with the ISO. But to keep things simple, the only thing I vary is the shutter speed. That's number one. Number two, almost any, the nice thing about total eclipses is no matter what shutter speed you use, you'll get an image of the corona. So I typically will shoot, I'll give you some numbers. I typically shoot at something like ISO 200. My telescopes are usually about F7 to F9. And I shoot a series of images from 1/1000th or 1/2000th of a second down to about 2 to 4 seconds at one f-stop, one doubling of shutter speed all the way through that sequence. And I'll go up and down several times to get overlapping exposures to add to this high dynamic range image. Now, in terms of video, I'm not a videographer. I'm mostly a photographer in terms of eclipses. And I simply use a small consumer or prosumer camcorder, and I just leave it basically on. I'll adjust the exposure and get it set so that it looks good on the sun during the partial phases, and I'll lock the exposure to manual, whatever that is, and then I just let the camera go. I don't play around with the exposure.
Awesome. And so we have one more question.
Let me add one more thing.
Sure.
Two eclipse websites. There's the AstroPix. There's EclipseWise.com, but my other website is MrEclipse.com, MrEclipse.com, and that website is all about eclipse photography. And I've got some tutorials on there on how to shoot eclipses with advice and settings and things like that. Plus a lot of examples of past eclipses that I've shot. So you can look at that kind of information on MrEclipse.com.
That's great. We can maybe post that in chat before the end of the program. We do have one more question. It might be a little involved, but I'm sure you can answer it very well. Can you give a short explanation of serocycles?
Serocycles, sure. I'll try. Well, there are several cycles that are important for eclipse prediction. One of them is from new moon to new moon. Obviously, it's got to be new moon to have an eclipse. That's called the synodic cycle. So that's approximately 29.5 day cycle. The second cycle is the draconic cycle. And that's the period that it takes the moon to go from the descending node around its orbit back to the same descending node. or ascending node, either one. One complete cycle with respect to the nodes of the moon's orbit. And the third cycle is the anomalistic orbit. And that's the period from perigee to perigee or apogee to apogee. And of course, because nature is perverse sometimes, none of these cycles are equal to each other. They're all off a little bit. So if you get a particular eclipse, for instance, on April 8th, 2024, and you look at the position of the moon with respect to, it's going to be a new moon, you look at where it is with respect to the node and where it is with respect to its distance, that's the anomalistic orbit from perigee to perigee, and you try to repeat that geometry. Well, if you run the moon forward in time or backward in time, all the orbits until you get those numbers close together again, you find that the same geometry very closely repeats itself every 18 years, 11 days. That is the Saros cycle. So if you get two eclipses separated by 18 years, 11 days, you will find that the eclipse takes place about the same time of year. The moon is about the same distance from the sun, so the duration is very similar. The big difference is that Saros, it's 18 years, 11 days, and 8 hours. And the 8 hours is the kicker, because that means that the Earth has rotated one third of the way around. So although all the geometry is very similar, it's visible from a different part of the world. So for instance, the previous eclipse to the 2024 eclipse that we're having in 4 years, the previous eclipse to that was in 2006. And that particular eclipse crossed Africa and Turkey. But other than that, it was very similar to the geometry to the 2024 eclipse. How was that?
That was perfect. Amazing. Wow.
It's easier to do this with diagrams.
Yeah, exactly. So that's it for questions. But there's a comment from Peter. He measured a 10 degrees Celsius ground temperature drop in Idaho Falls in 2017. Okay. He didn't expect it to change that much. And I'd just like to follow up with that. What's the largest temperature differential you've seen during a total eclipse, if you measure that at all?
I don't measure it. I've seen others measuring it. I think I've seen in the high teens.
Wow.
Like 15 or 16 degrees. But you know, it's just like weather. It depends on the time of year, the angle of the sun, factors like that affect it. A lot of variables involved in how much the temperature is gonna drop.
That's wonderful. So that's it for our questions. Again, on behalf of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, the Calgary Centre, we'd like to thank you for coming to join us online, unfortunately. We'll have to have you back when everything is settled and you can go on your Banff tour again. That'd be great. At this time, I'd like to turn it back over to Roland to kind of close out the meeting and present a few final words.
Thank you, Simon.
Well, truly inspiring talk. Thank you very much, Fred. And thank you, Simon, for handling the questions so well.
Thank you.
I'd like to acknowledge our partners at the Calgary Public Library for hosting us tonight and taking care of all the technical details behind the scenes here. I think they've done an excellent job. Thanks, Hamza and Kai. Personally. And just a reminder that our next event for the public is on Thursday, November 19th, Dr. Cherry Ng. She will be speaking about unraveling the mysterious fast radio burst with CHIME. That's at 7 p.m. And basically the same as this meeting. Please, if you're public, register via the Calgary Public Library website. And again, an advance notice for members that we are also going to have our annual general meeting and the second Zoom meeting right after we finish the presentation from Dr. Ng. As well, we have a further partnership with the Calgary Public Library with Saturday morning sessions for kids. Simon, you want to unmute? Maybe the program's pretty full, but you never know if people can get on a waiting list.
That's right, Roland. Thank you. So every Saturday morning, we provide a morning program for astronomy for youth ages 6 to 12. And of course, if you're older than that, or a parent, or somebody that's interested, you can, of course, still join. There's no real problem with that. We go through many different topics that are relevant to the time of the year. Actually, I'll pull up the topics for the upcoming. For from November to December, we're going to have a program on the autumn sky, constellations of the night sky, where we'll talk about kind of the sociological history and the mythology and how you can find them in the night sky. We're going to have a lesson on purchasing astronomy equipment for yourself and for your youth, so you get the most out of your money. We'll talk about moons of the solar system. So we won't stay with our own moon. We'll actually talk about the very interesting moons throughout our solar system. Then we'll have a lecture on the winter sky. The following week, we'll talk about meteor showers, the week of the Geminid meteor shower. And finally, we'll cap off the year with a high-level view overview of exoplanets. And that should be very exciting. And you can find that in the Calgary Public Library programs page. Just search for, or just scroll down and look for the different programs that we offer. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out to myself or Roland, and we'll certainly be able to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Simon. And I think maybe we'll leave the last word to Hamza from the Calgary Public Library.
Awesome. Thanks, Roland. First of all, on behalf of the Calgary Library, I would like to thank all the participants for being with us this evening. I hope everyone enjoyed the program, and I think everyone did, looking at the comments and the questions. Also, a big thank you to Fred, Roland, and Simon, and the Royal Astronomical Society for another wonderful online program. Thank you once again, everyone. We'll see you next time.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
See ya.
Thank you.